Ya, silakan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Selamat siang, salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Alhamdulillah, puji syukur kita panjatkan karena berkat rahmat Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, kita bisa berkumpul untuk menimba ilmu bersama narasumber kita yang dilaksanakan secara daring. Semoga kita senantiasa dalam kondisi sehat dan selalu dalam perlindungan Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Acara ini merupakan acara kuliah tamu yang diselenggarakan oleh Departemen Kesehatan Lingkungan dan bekerjasama dengan program studi Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan dan juga dengan Jurnal Kesehatan Lingkungan Akreditasi Jurnal Sinta 2 FKM Universitas Erlangga.
Selamat datang para peserta dan selamat bergabung di acara kuliah tamu pada siang hari ini dengan mengusung tema Tips of Publication Success in Malaysian Journal of Medicine and Health Science MJMHS UPM Malaysia. Izinkan saya memperkenalkan diri lebih dahulu. Nama saya Novidian Arfiani dan rekan saya Isnaini Rahmawati. Kami mahasiswa Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan FKM Universitas Erlangga. Selamat siang dan salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Terima kasih kepada Bapak Ibu yang telah hadir di acara kuliah tamu siang hari ini dan selamat datang kepada semua peserta yang sudah bergabung. Selamat datang dan selamat siang kami ucapkan kepada yang terhormat Ibu Dr. Santi Martini, Dr. Emkes, Dekan Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Airlangga, yang kami hormati Ibu Dr. Insinyur Lilis Sulistiorini, Emkes, Ketua Panitia dan Ketua Departemen Kesling FKM Universitas Airlangga, dan yang terhormat Ibu Dr. R. Azizah SHMkes, KPS Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan FKM Universitas Airlangga, yang terhormat Ibu Profesor Nurmala Ibrahim, narasumber kuliah tamu pada pagi hari ini dari Faculty of Medicine and Health Science University Putra Malaysia. Dan kami ucapkan selamat siang dan selamat datang kepada Profesor Sujaya Dikeman dan Profesor Riri Yudastuti yang sudah bergabung di acara kuliah tamu pada siang hari ini.
Baiklah, sebelum memulai acara, saya akan membacakan susunan acara tamu pada hari ini. Acara pertama yakni menyanyikan lagu Indonesia Raya. Acara kedua, sambutan sekaligus pembukaan oleh Ibu Dekan. Acara ketiga yaitu pemaparan materi oleh narasumber sekaligus diskusi dan tanya jawab yang dipandu oleh rekan kami Muhammad Azmi Ma'ruf SKM. Acara keempat yaitu penutupan dan doa. Untuk mengefisiensi waktu, langsung saja kita masuk pada acara pertama yakni menyanyikan lagu Indonesia Raya. Untuk yang bertugas kepada Saudara Rialdin SKM dipersilahkan.
Thank you.
Untuk memasuki agenda selanjutnya, yakni sambutan, kami persilahkan kepada Ibu Dekan Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Airlangga, Ibu Dr. Santi Martini, Dr. Emkes, untuk memberikan sambutan sekaligus membuka acara kuliah tamu pada siang hari ini.
Terima kasih moderator Mbak Novi. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Yang terhormat para guru besar, Prof. Sujayadi, Prof. Riri, Prof. Mukono, Ibu Ketua Departemen Dr. Lili Sulistiorini, dan Ibu Ketua Program Studi Dr. Aziza, serta Bapak Ibu dosen dari Departemen Kesehatan Lingkungan maupun prodi magister, program magister kesehatan lingkungan, serta tentunya yang saya cintai dan saya banggakan para mahasiswa, baik itu mahasiswa prodi UKL maupun program kesehatan masyarakat maupun mungkin ada program gizi maupun dari program magister lainnya serta dari program doktoral ya. Program studi kesehatan masyarakat.
Sama-sama. Mahasiswa luar negeri ada Bu Santi.
Magister.
Mahasiswa luar negeri dari Malaysia, dari beberapa negara.
Ya. Oh ya, terima kasih juga. Ya, yang saya hormati dan banggakan para mahasiswa dari universitas di Malaysia yang ikut juga pada kegiatan yang bagus ini.
Dari Nigeria serta, juga ada.
Dari Nigeria juga ada. Oh, banyak ya mahasiswa asingnya ya.
Ya.
Dan yang saya hormati dan banggakan Prof. Normala Ibrahim, our distinguished speaker now today, and also Prof. Juliana. Thank you very much for your coming. Ya. Pertama-tama marilah kita panjatkan puji syukur kehadirat Tuhan Yang Maha Esa yang telah melimpahkan rahmat dan hidayah-Nya pada kita semua, sehingga kita diberikan kesehatan, keselamatan, kemampuan, dan kemauan untuk menghadiri kegiatan yang sangat baik ini, yaitu kegiatan dalam upaya untuk meningkatkan keterampilan ya dari mahasiswa mempublikasikan karya ilmiahnya pada jurnal internasional. Dan saya lihat Departemen KL maupun Prodi S2 KL mengadakan webinar series ya terkait dengan hal ini. Jadi mengundang banyak narasumber dari berbagai universitas dengan narasumber yang juga punya pengalaman yang sudah tinggi terkait dengan publikasi di jurnal internasional. Dan kegiatan ini tentunya sangat bagus sekali karena mendukung apa yang menjadi tujuan atau visi dari baik Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat maupun Universitas Airlangga untuk menjadi Smart University maupun World Class University, yang mana salah satu indikator untuk penilaiannya adalah academic reputation. Dan academic reputation itu bisa dikenali melalui banyaknya publikasi. Dan tentunya tidak lupa selain banyaknya publikasi juga ini, citasi ya, citasinya, jadi dari apa yang sudah kita punya publikasi itu tentunya juga harus disitasi juga oleh para peneliti maupun kolega kita di baik itu di level nasional, di level internasional maupun oleh mahasiswa kita di level nasional, dan kemudian hasil citasinya itu juga harus dipublikasikan juga. Jadi pada artikel manuskrip yang dipublikasikan oleh siapapun itu juga sebaiknya dipublikasikan pada jurnal internasional juga. Jadi ini rentetannya banyak ya dari kegiatan ini, Bu Lilis maupun Bu Aziza ya. Jadi tidak hanya berhenti pada publikasi, tapi juga berikutnya adalah bagaimana publikasi itu banyak disitasi juga oleh para peneliti-peneliti maupun para peneliti yang ada di dunia ini ya. Karena ya itu tadi seperti saya sampaikan sebelumnya, jadi kita punya target ya, yang mana ini juga sudah diketahui oleh Bapak Ibu semua dan para mahasiswa, bahwa salah satu persyaratan untuk bisa lulus juga harus ada publikasinya. Dan memang diharapkan publikasinya itu bisa pada jurnal internasional. Jadi tidak hanya di level nasional, tapi sebaiknya juga dipublikasikan pada jurnal secara internasional atau di level internasional. Dan ini bukan waktu yang sedikit ya, maksudnya bukan waktu yang pendek untuk bisa melakukan itu. Sehingga membutuhkan waktu yang lama dan ada proses, maka memang sebaiknya publikasi untuk mahasiswa sebaiknya sedini mungkin, seawal mungkin itu dilakukannya. Dan kegiatan-kegiatan ini tentunya sangat sangat didukung oleh fakultas dan sebaiknya mungkin memang ada rutin ya, Bu Aziza maupun Bu Lilis. Jadi rutin kegiatannya ini mungkin setiap 3 bulan mungkin bisa ada. Dan tidak hanya berhenti di sini, tapi juga berlanjut monitoring. Jadi mungkin departemen dan prodi memonitor hasil dari setiap seperti ini, webinar ini, berapa banyak artikel yang akan disubmitkan oleh mahasiswa, kemudian sudah itu berapa banyak artikel yang kemudian publish dan membutuhkan waktu berapa lama. Jadi ini juga bagian dari peran departemen maupun prodi untuk memonitor, kalau departemen itu dosen-dosennya, kalau prodi tentunya mahasiswa. Begitu nih. Terima kasih, mungkin saya tidak akan berpanjang lebar. Sekali lagi kami menyampaikan terima kasih ya Prof. Normala, apa yang dulu Prof. Normala datang tahun 2017 dan akhirnya ini berlanjut terus. Ada aktivitinya ya. Pada waktu itu kita punya kerjasama, tidak hanya sekedar di atas kertas, tapi ternyata berlanjut, ada aktivitasnya. Dan Prof. Yuliana ini yang juga banyak punya kerjasama dengan kami, dengan FKM UNER, dan terima kasih atas supportnya Prof. Yuliana dan juga Prof. Normala. Dan kerjasama ini mungkin tidak hanya di kegiatan ini, tapi mungkin berlanjut juga misalnya ada joint research mungkin yang bisa kita develop juga. Kemudian kalau nggak salah ini nanti akan ada program double degree ya dengan prodi Prof. Yuliana. Pada waktu itu saya ingat sekali disampaikan oleh Prof. Normala sangat membutuhkan double degree ya seperti itu. Dan alhamdulillah itu akan segera terwujud ya kalau nggak salah ya Prof. Yuliana.
Ya, insya Allah Rabu meeting sama Prof. Yuliana.
Ya.
Prof. Juliana ada.
Ya. Baik, terima kasih sekali atas supportnya dan kerjasama selama ini dan mudah-mudahan berlanjut terus untuk untuk kegiatan-kegiatan yang lainnya, mungkin akan lebih banyak variasinya dan nanti kedepannya mungkin bisa jadi bisa kita undang juga sebagai external examiner. Untuk mahasiswa S3 kami, kita punya program studi doctoral program public health dan kita punya student dalam setahun itu ada 25 orang setiap tahun dan ini sangat kita sangat terbuka misalnya ada external examiner. Apalagi dengan pandemi ini semua dilaksanakan secara daring dan ini sangat memungkinkan sekali untuk bisa kita wujudkan. Baik, terima kasih. Sekali lagi Prof. Normala
atas sama-sama Ibu
ya, Prof. Yuliana juga atas waktunya juga join dengan kami dan juga terima kasih kepada Kadep Kesehatan Lingkungan Bu Lilis dan KPS S2KL Prof. Aziza dan Prof. Lilis dan juga tentunya dukungan dari guru besar yang ada di para senior yang ada di Departemen KL Prof. Sujayadi Prof. Mukono, tentunya ini sangat penting bagi kita semua mendapatkan dukungan dari para senior yang sudah lebih berpengalaman. Dan terima kasih juga kepada para mahasiswa yang telah ikut dalam kegiatan ini dan mudah-mudahan ini berlanjut ya, jadi ada outputnya. Baik, Baik, saya akhiri. Mohon maaf kalau ada yang hal-hal yang kurang berkenan. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Salam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih Ibu Dr. Santi Martini, Dr. Mkes atas sambutan Ibu dan sekaligus pembuka acara pada kuliah tamu siang hari ini. Kami ucapkan selamat datang dan selamat bergabung kepada yang terhormat Profesor Dr. Haji Mukono yang merupakan guru besar Departemen Kesehatan Lingkungan dan kepada yang terhormat Profesor Madya Dr. Juliana Jalaluddin dari Fakulti Perubatan dan Sains Kesehatan Universitas Putra Malaysia. Baik, selanjutnya kita masuk ke dalam sesi yang sudah ditunggu-tunggu, yaitu pemaparan materi sekaligus diskusi dan tanya-jawab oleh narasumber di mana nanti akan dipandu secara langsung oleh Muhammad Asmi Ma'ruf SKM kepada rekan saya Muhammad Asmi Ma'ruf SKM. SKM, kami persilakan untuk langsung memandu pemaparan materi dan diskusi.
Terima kasih atas kesempatannya MC. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Perkenalkan kembali, nama saya Muhammad Azmi Ma'ruf, mahasiswa Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan, Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Erlangga. Pada kesempatan hari ini berperan sebagai moderator. Sesi kali ini kita akan mendengarkan pemaparan materi dari Profesor Dr. Nurmala Ibrahim, Faculty of Medicine and Health Science UPM, dengan materi Tips of Publication Success in Malaysian Journal of Medicine and Health Science, MGMHS. Izinkan saya untuk menampilkan CV dari Profesor Dr. Nurmala Ibrahim. Profesor Dr. Nurmala Ibrahim, Department of Psychiatry, Faculty of Medicine and Health Science, University Putra Malaysia. Selain berkarir sebagai pengajar, beliau juga adalah seorang general psychiatrist, providing service and skills in diagnosis and treatment of major psychiatric disorder among adults, inpatient and outpatients. Selain itu juga sebagai seorang peneliti dengan special interest di area risk behavior dari young adults, seperti itu. Pendidikan yang telah ditempuh oleh beliau diantaranya PhD Community Health University Putra Malaysia, Med Psychiatry University Kebangsaan Malaysia, Bachelor Degree and University of College Dublin, dan sekarang salah satu profesi sekarang adalah Consultant of Psychiatrist di Department of Psychiatry Hospital Pengajar UPM. Selain itu juga beliau memiliki banyak pengalaman di berbagai macam organisasi dan juga pengalaman mengajar dan juga penelitian. Selanjutnya kita berikan kesempatan kepada Profesor Dr. Nurmala Ibrahim. Pada nantinya apabila ada peserta yang hendak bertanya, dipersilahkan dengan menggunakan kolom chat menyebutkan nama, nama dan pertanyaannya apa. Kami berikan kesempatan kepada Profesor Dr. Nurmala Ibrahim untuk memaparkan materinya.
Oke. Oh, terima kasih ya. Terima kasih Cik Muhammad Azmi ya. For the kind introduction ya. Okay, sayanya menggunakan bahasa campur-campur ya.
That's okay. That's
yeah, yeah. I'm not sure because there is non Indonesian speaking as well. Is it?
Yeah.
Jadinya,
not all from Indonesia.
Huh?
Not everyone in here from Indonesia.
Yeah, yeah. But I think non Indonesian speaking kan. Jadinya perlu kot berbahasa Inggeris dan mungkin sedikit-sedikit gitu bahasa Indonesia yang sikit saja saya tahu dan bahasa Melayu lah. Eh? Okay. Baik. Alright. I think. You want me to share the slides, is it? Ibu Lilis.
I can share the slides with for you.
Ah, yeah, yeah. Can you share the slides for me?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright. Okey, terima kasih Departemen Kesihatan Lingkungan, terima kasih Bu Ajiza, terima kasih Ibu Santi dan terima kasih Bu Lilis ya kerana menjemput saya untuk berkongsi or sharing my experience ya, experience in looking at the journal the manuscript ya from the point of chief editor of the journal. And before that, I would like to congratulate Ibu Santi ya for the appointment of being the new dean of the school.
Yeah, thank of you, Prof.
Alright, terima kasih. Congratulations ya, Ibu Santi.
Sama, terima kasih.
Fakultas lebih akan terus ke hadapannya. Okay, and I'm glad that this collaboration actually continue up until now, even with the COVID, yeah, we still can actually meet each other through this platform. Yeah. So memang benar apa yang Ibu Santi kata, kita we came to UNAIR in 2017 with such a big group, yeah, with such a big group, and we discussed what were the collaboration that we would want to plan. And alhamdulillah, one of the continuous collaboration that we have is through Prof. Juliana. Yeah, Prof. Juliana, I think up until now she has been committed to collaborate with UNAIR. Yeah, and alhamdulillah juga kita lihat banyak begitu ya, all the submission from UNAIR into our journal.
Okay.
I think it started with some special issues, conference issues. Yeah. Now we are beginning to receive more and more. Yeah.
Yeah.
Screen sharing tidak terlihat oleh peserta webinar. Enggak boleh nampak ya?
Sudah tampak.
Itu ada chatnya di situ ya.
Sudah nampak.
Sudah kan? Okay.
Sudah.
Okay.
Sudah.
Okay, my session for today is mainly just a very very casual one. Yeah, kita berbicara secara casual. Kita ingin melihat di mana tips yang perlu ya untuk mahasiswa untuk for you to be able to successfully publish in our journal. Yeah. Because I have seen as a chief editor, because I screen all the manuscript. Yeah, I screen all the manuscript, and I actually allocate the manuscript to associate editor for them to invite all the reviewers. Yeah, so somehow I have noticed what would be the areas that you all can improve in order to make it successful to be published in MJMHS. Yeah. Okay. So I think. Okay. The next one. Next slide. Okay. My outline for the lecture today, the session today, is to give you a brief introduction of MJMHS and how we actually process our publication, and what are the reasons for rejection in publication, and what would be the criteria for successful publication in MJMHS. Yeah? So I think in a way that we would want to help you to improve your manuscript so that you'll be able to publish more and to be able to publish successfully in our journal. Yeah? Okay, next. Okay, just a very brief introduction to our journal. So our journal is actually published by UPM Press. Penerbit, yeah? Penerbit UPM. And it is managed by Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences. And our journal is actually indexed in Scopus. So we have been indexed in Scopus for the past many years. And now we are, within these 3 years, we are actually moving into JCR index. Yeah? Meaning that previously it was known as ISI. So meaning that we are aiming for higher quality for this journal. Yeah? Next. Okay, so this is basically what it looks like on the website. Okay. Next. Okay, how do we actually progress, yeah? With regards to this journal, previously there were only 2 issues per year, January and June. Yeah, we published 2 issues per year, but since 2017, we have published 3 issues, January, June and October. And starting this year, because we received overwhelming submissions, yeah? And to tell you, we divide our submission into local, you know, those authors coming from the local, from Malaysia, and those authors from coming from international. And most majority of the international submissions actually comes from Indonesia. So, you know, and because we collaborated earlier with UNAIR, jadinya UNAIR itu yang paling banyak sekali dalam kategori dari negara Indonesia itu, ya. Jadi kita nampak UNAIR semakin banyak menghantar kepada kita. Yeah. So in this year, we have actually increased our issues into 4 issues. Yeah, 4 issues: January, May, September. We have published this. If you look at our website, we have actually uploaded all these 3 issues, and then the December pun kita sudah cukup, ya, sudah cukup sebenarnya. Sudah cukup numbers of articles to be published. So we are actually now formatting dan juga membuat turutannya, ya, the organization of the journal, ya, yeah? Untuk December 2020, ya, yeah? So this year alone, I think kita publish untuk 4 issues di dalam 2020 ini sebanyak hampir actually 200 articles, eh? Up to 200 articles, and our submission, eh? We receive submission from all over. Up until now is about 800 submissions. Eh? Okay, you just imagine, eh? 800 submissions, and we only can cater about 200 published articles. So it means that the rejection rejection rate is getting higher and higher. Yeah. And our focus on the results of original scientific research and development, emerging issues and policy analyzed pertaining to medical, biomedical and clinical science. So because it is medicine and health sciences, so everything under medicine and health sciences we actually cater. Okay. Next. Okay, these are the editorial board members. So myself as the chief editor, then we have our members from different departments, yeah, but within the faculty, yeah, and we have our international as advisory board members from Australia, from UK, and from Singapore as well. Okay. Okay, this is the current editorial board members. Next. Okay, what are the article categories, yeah, that we receive is actually original article. Original article or full article that should come from your research, yeah, your research project, yeah. And then we do have receive review article. I think recently, I think a few of you have submitted your review. Eh? So it can be narrative review, it can be systematic review and meta-analysis. Yeah, the one that I think Ibu Lilis gave me a few lists, eh? A list of articles that have been submitted. I think 2 or 3 actually have wrote on review. Yeah? And then you have case report. Okay, case report, I think the other day one of the authors, yeah, I think also from Indonesia, but I'm not sure whether from UNAIR or the other universities, were asking whether they can actually send a case report in relation to environmental health, eh, kesihatan lingkungan. Jadi kita kata, yeah, we do accept and we look at the format and it's actually acceptable. Eh? It's one of the interesting case report. And maybe this is something you can actually think about. Eh? And you can have short commentary, yeah, and letter to editors, and also short communication. But mind you, Ibu Santi, when you talk about this ranking, yeah, looking at the type of publication that they're looking at is actually more of original article, review article, yeah, and some may accept case report if you publish them in an index journal, yeah. Kita kan itu ada journal tu ada index dan non-index, ya. Kalau QS dia memang lihat kepada index journal. Jadi Scopus, yeah. Scopus is one of the largest database in the world, yeah. So that's why people, most of the journals, yeah, most of the journals they are indexed in Scopus, yeah. But if you want to go for higher quality, you should look for JCR, which is Journal Citation a report, yeah, which is under the Clarivate analytic. Okay, next. Okay, this is the submission process. It is online submission. Yeah, you go through this this website. Okay, this address. Yeah, and then if you're the first timer, then you need to register. Yeah, register, get your own password, then you create your own account. Yeah. Then subsequently, if you want to submit again, then you use the same account. Yeah. So you need to complete all the required document as stated in the manuscript preparation section. Okay. At the moment, we are still free. Yeah. For the regular issue, the four issues, we are still free. But starting from January 2021, okay, we are going to implement we are going to start our processing fee, article processing fee, which is not expensive, eh? Is about 200 ringgit Malaysia, eh? 200 ringgit Malaysia, 50 ringgit per processing fee, but once it's accepted, then you need to pay 200 ringgit. So all in is actually 250 ringgit, eh? Which is about I'm not sure dalam rupiahnya berapa, ya. Tapi sangat murah lah ini, ya. Sebenarnya memang sangat murah dibandingkan dengan jurnal-jurnal di Malaysia yang lain, ya. Kita ada jurnal di Malaysia, a few journals which has similar categories like us, medicine and health sciences. One is you pay about 1,500. Ringgit Malaysia, and the other one is about 600 to 700 ringgit Malaysia. Yeah, so we are still very cheap. Yeah, this is actually to support our peer review system. Yeah, the system that we use for peer review, we are using Scholar One. Yeah, so basically we just want to actually pay for that lah. Yeah? So that's why we need to start our article processing fee. Okay, next.
Yes. I just get the info. Jadi 250 ringgit Malaysia is around 800,000 rupiah, kan? So 900,000 rupiah.
Yeah. Ini maksudnya jika mau submit saja sudah bayar 50, ya, 50 ringgit. 50 ringgit itu berapa, ya?
Around 200,000.
200,000. Jadi boleh, ya. 200,000 submit, tapi kalau sudah accepted itu kena tambah 200 gitu. Ya, yeah? 200 ringgit. So, this is starting January. So, and all submissions from January 2021 onwards, ya. Yeah? So akan dikenakan bayaran gitu. Ya. Yeah? Okay, so this is our website. If you go to our website, you go to MJMHS website. So this is the front page of the account for submission lah, eh, for online submission. Kita sekarang ini sedang dalam proses membuat satu website baru, ya. Website baru kerana kita sekarang ini perlu untuk masuk, we want to aim for indexing in PubMed, ya. Yeah? PubMed is where is a database mainly for medicine, ya. Yeah? Because majority of medical people, if they want to find articles, yeah, they go straight into PubMed, ya. Yeah? They don't go to Scopus, they go to PubMed. So we need to be indexed in that PubMed to increase our citation. Ya? Yeah? Macam tadi Ibu Santi ada mention kan, bukan sahaja kita perlu untuk publish, tetapi we have to make sure that our publication will be cited. Ya? Yeah? So untuk meningkatkan lagi citation. Jadi kita memang aim di MJMHS supaya most of our articles will be cited. Ya? Yeah? So in order to get it, to increase the citation numbers, we need to go into more specific database, yeah, which is one for medical, and also within 3 years, we hope to go into JCR, which is much more easier for people to actually increase your citation. Yeah. Okay, next. Okay. Apa yang kita buat ya dalam proses submission, so all your submitted manuscript, we will screen for plagiarism. Alright? So we use our Turnitin software to look at plagiarism. Okay, plagiarism ini sangat, bukan apa ya, bukan kadang-kadang kita bukan intentionally to plagiarize. Ya. Kadang-kadang kita quote dari certain journals, ya, dan kadang-kadang kita sort of copy ayat tu ya, ayat we copy the sentences ya, without the intention to plagiarize ya. It's just that sometimes it's very difficult for us to rephrase the words ya. So kadang-kadang common words ya, common words itu memang muncul ya, memang muncul di mana-mana. Jadi dia akan still will be identified as plagiarism. So as you know, when we do Turnitin software, yeah, we're looking at the similarity index. Yeah? So our requirement is the similarity index should be less than 30%. Yeah? Jadi selalunya kita, kalau similarity index itu tinggi, kita selalu unsubmit. Unsubmit, ya. Yeah? Kita bukan reject terus gitu. Kita unsubmit and we advise the authors to rephrase or you know, do paraphrasing of your words, yeah, so that it will be lower down the similarity index, yeah. Dan kadang-kadang because although you have low similarity index, lower than 30%, sometimes each of your citation yeah, from other reference tu, dia lebih dari 2%. Ya. Yeah? Jadi ada yang kadang-kadang kita lihat 6%, ya, yeah, 7%. So that one we scrutinize, ya, yeah? Kita tengok dan kita suggest you buat paraphrasing gitu. Ya, yeah? Dan kita tidak reject terus gitu ya. Yeah? Kita advise that you paraphrase and then you resubmit. You resubmit using the same account. Yeah, resubmit using the same account. It's not the new account. Yeah, the new numbers. Yeah, resubmit again. Okay. Okay. So we also want to ensure that all your research projects related to human subjects must receive approval from ethics committee, and this should be stated in the manuscript. Yang ini saya mau kepastian ya dari department, sama ada semua your research, ya, all your research. Do they go through the ethics committee? Itu jawatan kuasa etika gitu.
Mungkin dari Ibu Aziza bisa bantu.
Ya.
Atau Bu Lilis mungkin. Belum ada jawapan, mungkin
belum ada jawapannya. Mungkin kita kembali lagi persoalan ini ya. Kerana memang ini adalah salah satu requirement ya dalam journal ya. Bila kita ada journal, kita mesti pastikan sekiranya if your research is related to human subjects, they should have received approval ya. Ethics approval from your own committee, yeah. Okay, next.
Yes, me.
Yeah, yeah, Lilis.
Iya, ada kita deh. Aduh kan kalau apa mau penelitian harus layak etik dulu. Ada komisi etiknya juga.
Ada ya? Jadi ada. Kalau ada selalunya kita mohon untuk di you have to state it in the publication, ya. Yeah? Ethical consideration. So you know this study has received ethical approval from the board, yeah. And then in order to look at the vulnerability or something like that, yeah. Okay. Okay. Setelah dokumen semua telah disemak, yeah, dilihat dan dicukup, yeah. All the documents, relevant documents submitted, fulfill the checklist, yeah. And then your plagiarism check is also below 30% of similarity index, yeah. Then the chief editor, okay, saya selalunya akan allocate to the associate editors, AE, yeah, your associate editors. And associate editors akan kemudian mencari atau menulis email kepada semua reviewers. Tetapi kadang-kadang it will be good, eh? It will be good that if you can suggest your reviewers. Alright, if you submit, you suggest, because there's a column for you to actually suggest your reviewers. Eh? So if you have, maybe you could suggest one or two or more than that reviewers, because our requirement, we only proceed with the peer. We only proceed with the acceptance process if we have received at least two peer reviewers comment. Yeah. Jadi kalau selalunya itu associate editor, ya, dia akan akan memilih lebih dari sekurang-kurangnya lebih more than 4 reviewers. Ya, yeah, kadang-kadang kita itu enggak dapat nama, eh, susah mau dapat nama. Sebab kalau you pilih, if you choose 2 reviewers, satu tolak itu, eh, jadi kitanya perlu lagi mencari. Jadi sekurang-kurangnya memang dikatakan kepada AE, eh, associate editors, you need to select at least 4 peer reviews. 4 reviewers, because if let's say one turn down, then 3 accept, you know, and at least when the 2 reviewers send back their comments, then we can actually proceed. Yeah, okay. Dan juga all the reviewers, they are actually double blinded. Yeah, the review process is double blinded. The reviewer do not know who are you, and the authors also do not know who the reviewers are. Yeah, and it is managed online. Everything is online. Yeah. So authors are encouraged to name their recommended reviewers. You boleh recommend, yeah? Tetapi they wouldn't know who are you. The reviewers, if you recommend, they wouldn't know actually who are you, yeah? The authors. And editorial board, the AE, yeah, associate editor, will select reviewers who are qualified in the field to review the articles. Dan that sepatutnya dalam proses peer reviewer, the review process should take about 21 days based on our guidelines, yeah, the standard operating guideline. The reviewer should take about 21 days. However, if you go to other journals as well, if you look at other, you know, most of the journals, this is the problem. When the reviewers do not stick to the timeline, the time frame, yeah. So our system, they actually send automatic emails to remind the reviewers, yeah, to remind the reviewers that they should submit their review within 21 days, yeah. Dan bagi untuk proses, yeah, proses admin checklist semua itu, ianya lebih kurang 1 minggu gitu. Yeah, so 7 days and 21 days. So all in, by right, you have 28 days. So about 1 month. Yeah, 1 month, you should be able to get feedback for the first feedback. Okay? Most of the time, feedback, yeah, the first review feedback should come, we estimate should come within 1 month. Yeah? Tetapi ini bergantung, yeah, depends on the reviewer. Okay, sometimes we really have to chase after the reviewer, yeah? Asking them to complete their reviews. Yeah? Okay, next. Okay, so it's 21 days. Okay. And revision process by authors should be within 14 days. Ah, okay. Dalam sistem itu kan automatic kan. Kalau 21 days, reviewers sudah bagi feedback gitu. Jadi authors should revise within 14 days. Okay. Sebab sistem itu dia akan lock. Ya. Yeah? Sistem akan lock sekiranya kita lebih dari 14 days. Tetapi most of the time, the authors would request to the chief editor to extend the time frame. So we usually would entertain. Kita akan beri masa lagi, ya. Yeah? Beri masa dan buka sistem itu untuk masuk. Tetapi we encourage that you stick to the time frame. Ya, yeah? Macam baru-baru ni sebab because of COVID, eh, I think I have one author's request to me that could we extend the revision time frame because she is infected with COVID. Okay? Dianya infected with COVID, jadinya enggak, mungkinlah enggak sihat, ya, untuk membuat revision. Jadi kita we entertain that. Ya? Yeah? Okay? We are also human, ya. Yeah? We are also human. We do entertain, ya. Yeah? Okay, decision on manuscripts are made in accordance to the uniform requirements of manuscripts submitted to biomedical journal. So this is actually standard all over the world, ya. Yeah? So all journals must have the decision based on this requirement, ya. Yeah? Okay? Okay, bagaimana pula, okay, when do we actually, at what stage can we actually reject your articles, eh? Okay, one, okay, like I said, if you have issues with plagiarism or your similarity index is high, we do not reject outrightly. Most of the time, we unsubmit. Yeah, and submit meaning that you do the correction and you can resubmit. Yeah, however, sometimes, yeah, when the chief editor, at the stage of chief editor can actually because he or she, yeah, reads all manuscript and maybe just the abstract or maybe just scan through the article. Okay, so if he or she feels that the article doesn't meet the requirement, or meaning that the content, yeah, the content or the scientific content is not sufficient, okay, there's lack of scientific merit, he or she can actually reject outrightly, yeah, the editor, the chief editor. Eh? And sometimes the chief editor doesn't have time to read all, so they would start to allocate to the associate editor. Okay? And associate editor can actually read. Eh? They actually by right, they should read. Eh? They should read all. Okay? And, you know, scan through the article. And they can also reject if they feel that, you know, it doesn't meet the requirement of the journal. Yeah? They can reject at that stage. So, chief editor can reject. Associate editor can reject. And if associate editor said, okay, we should send for review process, they send, and this is where it can be rejected as well, through, by the reviewers. Okay, by the reviewers. And the best thing, although sometimes you become trauma, ya, yeah? Huh? Dalam proses kena reject itu trauma gitu, ya. Yeah? Ini traumanya lebih dari putus cinta gitu. Ha. Ya. Yeah? If you're rejected and you get comments from the reviewers, this is very good actually. This is to your advantage because you can use that comment to revise your paper and you submit, okay, submit into another journal. Yeah. So that's why I would encourage reviewers, yeah, reviewers, you know, if you want to reject the manuscript, do write something about it so that the writers, the authors, yeah, can actually use that comment and to revise, and then they can actually help them to submit into another journal. Yeah. So bukan ya, reviewers itu kadang-kadang ha, memang ada reviewers yang terus reject. Yeah, reject tanpa ada alasan. Jadi memang susah gitu untuk di justify. Yeah. At the end of the day, the chief editor has to justify kenapa itunya di reject. Yeah. Manuscript itu di reject. Yeah. Okay. What will be the issues in submission process? Ini yang memang kita selalu lihat. Yeah. The authors doesn't follow the guidelines. Ini kalau you tengok dalam mana-mana journals, kan setiap journals itu ada authors guideline kan. Jadi saya pun gitu heran gitu ya. Mengapa authors tidak mahu mengikut guidelines? Yeah? Setiap journal ada format-formatnya tersendiri. Yeah? All journals they have their own format. Meaning that how you format it in term of your you know, subsection of the paper, yeah, and then your reference, they follow certain style, maybe APA style, Vancouver style, yeah. So when they said that in the author's guideline, you should follow, because if you go for a very high impact journal, they just look at your format. Once your format is wrong, although your content is very good, they reject outrightly without looking at the content, because they say you don't follow the guideline. Ini yang kita selalu nampak di MJMHS, ya. Authors do not follow the guidelines. Dan saya pun enggak faham ya, kalau kita mau submit, selalunya kita akan tengok, we look at the guidelines. Apa dia kata dalam guidelines itu, then we follow. Yeah? Okay. And the second one is actually plagiarism. Yeah? So yang ini yang kalau dilihat, kalau di admin process checklist itu, ya, kita selalu lihat, saya akan menerima, I receive emails. I receive emails, all unsubmit, unsubmit, unsubmit. Yeah? Unsubmit tu sama ada doesn't follow the author's guideline or that's plagiarism, meaning that the similarity index is higher. Yeah? Sometimes, why the similarity index is higher? Kadang-kadang bila sebelum, ada authors ya, yang sebelum, before they submit into journals, yeah, they usually go, they go and they do their plagiarism check themselves. And sometimes we forgot, we forget because we put our manuscript inside the repository. So when you have your manuscript in the repository, when you do another checklist, for software plagiarism, then they identify it's 90%, almost 100% similarity. Whereas you know that that is your work, yeah. So bila you tengok kepada Turnitin itu, kalau guna Turnitin, you have to uncheck, you jangan tick itu repository. Meaning your manuscript would not be identified in the repository, yeah. Next. Okay, what will be the reasons for publication rejection? Next. Okay, sebelum itu, just to highlight a few things, why do we write? Kita kalau di Malaysia, kita lihat, semuanya research itu kan dibuat, dan telah complete, we complete our research. Tetapi when it comes to writing, there's always a problem. And this is what my experience is. Yeah, my last time, my supervisors were saying, yes, research, S3, S2, you can do everything. PhD, master, you can collect data. But some people have, you know, they are struggling to write. Write, bukan tulis publication saja, tulis thesis itu. Ya, kadang-kadang sudah habis semuanya, sudah complete data collection tetapi tidak tulis thesis. What more to write a publication? Yeah? So basically, why do we write? We want to communicate our findings to fellow colleagues or scientists, and our findings may contribute to the existing body of knowledge. And we also want to help other people to interpret results of their own research, because they would cite our research project, and then it helps in interpreting their own results. Yeah? Next. Okay, reason why we write. Of course, one is to gain intellectual stimulation. We want to share ideas. We want to report research. Yeah? We want to express our opinion. And we want to generate discussion. And some may use this as an advance to their own discipline. And other people want to assert ownership of a topic. So sekiranya, if you're saying that you're the expert in this area, so you want to assert ownership of a topic, then you should write and you should publish. And some may use this as a promotion, incentive for promotion. Yeah, so you want to attain promotion. Yeah, kalau di UPM memang publication itu salah satu kriteria untuk kenaikan pangkat gitu, promotion. And you want to report a case, you want to enhance one's personal reputation. And some people, they do earn income when they write, especially the ghost writers and everything, they write for other people, so they earn income. Okay, next. Okay, reason for not writing. Ya, saya anggap di UNAR juga ada isu for not difficult to writing, to write. Ya. Yeah? Kenapa selalunya not enough time, dikatakan enggak cukup masa gitu, And nothing to write about. Ini tidak boleh diterima lah, Kalau sudah buat research project, there must be something to write about. No one to work with in writing. Ini juga saya rasa satu alasan yang tak boleh diterima, Kerana kita kalau buat research itu, kita selalu ada team, ada team. And lack of secretarial support, ini mungkin di setengah-setengah tempat. And lack of knowledge as to how research information. And no mentor for writing activities. So most of the mahasiswa, you all have supervisors. Yeah, you all have supervisors and they should be your mentor. And no motivation, no self-confidence, and don't know how to start. And yang last kali itu, I hate writing. Yeah, I hate writing ini enggak boleh buat apa-apa lah. Dia memangnya, buat macam mana pun dia memang tidak suka writing. Yeah. Yang ini mungkin kena pergi satu kursus satu course in order to change the attitude So yang ini enggak boleh buat apa-apalah Okay. Next. Okay, motivation and satisfaction for publishing. Okay. So 78% majority would say that they are motivated. And they have satisfaction in publishing because they are able to disseminate their research finding, meaning that they want to share that. And 63% will say it's a form of peer recognition and peer reputation. And then some people, they say when they publish, they can actually translate it into their practice. Kalau di kesihatan lingkungan, mungkin apa yang kita buat research itu, mungkin boleh ditranslatekan into the way that we practice. Contohnya kalau kita membuat satu research mengenai sama ada satu intervensi itu efektif atau tidak, jadi sekiranya kalau efektif, mungkin kita boleh implement dalam kita punya practice, And then dalam bentuk is a form of education role. Okay, and then career advancement, yang ini tadi kita cakap promotion, And primacy or novelty finding, if it's a groundbreaking research, groundbreaking research. Ya, kita buat satu research yang very fundamental, ya. Then it can actually helps others to actually pursue in that area, ya. And pressure from institution. Ya, ini kalau di UPM itu benar, ya. Pressure from institution, ya. Kami ini di sini dipastikan untuk menulis, ya. Dan setiap lecturer, setiap dosen itu ada research profiling, ya. Ada karakteristiknya, ya. Kamu merah ke, kuning ke, hijau ke, ya. Kalau merah itu di zone merah gitu, ya. Zone merah maksudnya engkau tidak publish gitu, ya. So in summary, we like it or not, we still need to publish despite we are the best clinician or practitioner, ya. So kalau di UNERA, saya difahamkan tadi daripada Ibu Santi, mahasiswa memang you have to publish, ya, in order to graduate. Is it correct?
Yeah, it's correct.
Yeah, it's correct, ya.
Yeah.
You have to is it
a requirement for
accepted?
Graduation.
Yeah, accepted or published?
Accepted.
Accepted saja, ya.
Yeah.
Okay.
Except for doctoral program. For doctoral program, they have to publish.
So it means, yeah, you need to publish, whereas the rest is accepted lah. Eh?
Yeah.
Submitted, diterima enggak?
No.
Okay, accepted and so published. Eh?
Yes. Yeah.
And it must be in index journal.
For doctoral program must be index journal,
uh-huh.
But for master program, they can publish in national journal,
okay,
indexed by our scheme, yeah, or program, yeah.
Okay.
But for the grade is different. If they can publish in international journal indexed by Scopus or Web Science, the grade is higher than.
Okay, so you give grades to this,
yes,
public. Okay, all right. Okay. Next. Okay, main reasons for rejection of articles. Yeah, ini study yang dibuat, ya. They say one is lack of originality. Yeah, about 40% articles are rejected because of lack of originality. Okay, kalau di MJMHS, kita bukan satu journal yang berimpak tinggi, ya. We are not, our journal is not yet there, okay. So, kita bukanlah kata you must publish an original research, ya. Maknanya tak ada orang pun yang buat research itu, kecuali kita. Dan itu sebenarnya bukan, kita tidak melihat kepada itu, ya. Kita lihat enggak apa kalau kita actually repeat other people's works, but that should be of a scientific, that should be scientifically justified, yeah. Then most of the time, yeah, looking for originality is more required by the high impact journals lah. Kalau Lancet ke, yeah, itu New England Journal of Medicine ke, itu memang mungkin mereka melihat kepada originality, ya. Yeah? Problems with methodology and results. I think this is one area that all of us, okay, all of us, not just Indonesia, I mean in Malaysia also, we'll see, all of us should improve, ya. Yeah? Ini saya rasa akan saya detailkan lagi, ya. Yeah? What do you mean by problems of methodology and also results? And then some articles, yeah, they receive or negative and inappropriate comments by reviewers. Okay, so again, it becomes because there are negativity and inappropriate comments by the reviewers. Sometimes at the level of the chief editor, they just based on that and they reject. Yeah, and poor choice of the journal by the authors. Okay, sometimes kita select, ya, kita pilih journal yang tidak bersesuaian, ya. And the fourth one, the fifth one is actually poor English or writing quality. Okay, ini dia actually is a global problem for a non-English speaking countries like Indonesia, like Malaysia. Walaupun kita kadang-kadang authors itu memang excellent Englishnya, tetapi kebanyakan journal yang overseas, yang English speaking journals, the moment dia tengok dari negara-negara yang bukan English speaking, dia terus kadang-kadang dia suggest for proofreading. Yang ini saya akan bincangkan, bagaimana kita boleh membantu, how can we actually help in order to improve the writing quality, And then the last one is conflicts of interest were rarely mentioned. So this is very small percentage. Next. Okay, what are the characteristics of a good scientific writer? Knowledge. Okay, knowledge, knowledge about your content, or about the methodology, and knowledge about the writing, the writing knowledge, And then you should practice. And then you should have some experience when you have gone into the scientific writing. And okay, yang empat ini sangat penting. Capacity to endure rejection. Macam saya kata, kalau putus cinta, gitu. Dan sebenarnya rejection dalam menulis artikel ini lebih teruk daripada putus cinta. Kerana ada authors yang sekali kena reject, langsung tidak mau meneruskan tulisannya. They have stopped writing. They say it was very traumatized for them. Trauma gitu ya. Trauma, enggak boleh meneruskan lagi. Kerana traumanya bila di reject, dapat komen panjang gitu ya. Jadi enggak tahu macam mana untuk dilihat kembali paper itu. And a strong will to succeed. So you must have a strong determination. You want to publish. It doesn't matter how many times you were rejected. You still want to publish. So that strong determination would actually help you. Okay. Next. Okay. Successful publication in MGMHS. Okay. So first, you need to know what is a good scientific paper. Kalau dilihat kepada guidelines, author's guidelines in MGMHS, dia mesti ada title, mesti ada abstract, mesti ada introduction, mesti ada methods, means results and discussion. And what should you write in those section? Okay, so generally title, what is it all about? Abstract, what has been done in a very concise form? Introduction, what is the problem and why do you want to do the research? Methods, how was it done and solved? Result, what was found? And discussion, what did it mean? Okay, so ini summary-nya ya. Ini ringkasannya ya. Apa yang sepatutnya berada di dalam what make a good scientific paper. Okay, next. Okay, kalau di dalam title ya. Title selalu itu memberi satu impression. First impression of a scientific article. Macam mana kita mau menarik ya? How do we want to attract people to read our paper? So it should describe the content of the paper briefly and accurately. So indicate subject matter and very informative and attractive. And as much as possible, few words as possible ya. Kalau di Indonesia, kalau di Malaysia UPM, title tidak boleh lebih dari 20 perkataan. It cannot exceed more than 20 words. So kalau panjang-panjang gitu ya, memang akan kita minta authors untuk revise. And keywords in the work descriptions to help to be identified in search engine. So you must identify appropriate suitable keywords. And the title should be self-explanatory. Bila you baca title, certain journal, you baca title certain manuscript, you sudah faham apa content dia di dalam setiap manuscript itu. Okay, next. Okay, this is the example I give. The top one and the bottom one. A novel study on the use of cognitive remediation in the treatment of schizophrenia analysis neuropsychology deficit comparison with other 200 outpatients at UPM University Hospital. Compared to the bottom one, cognitive remediation therapy in the treatment of neuropsychological deficit of schizophrenia. So which one do you prefer?
It should be the bottom one.
Yeah. Okay. Kalau di UPM, ini yang atas tu ya, the top one would not be accepted. It's more than 20 words actually. Yeah. So the bottom one, you know, somehow give a general idea what is this paper all about. Yeah. Okay, next. Okay, what about this? CRT yeah, in schizophrenia and CRT rocks. So, is it acceptable? No, eh?
No.
Because one, the top one is not specific enough. And then, it use abbreviations, eh? Short form. So, you are not encouraged to use short form in your title. And the top, the second one is not scientific, yeah? So, you should avoid jargon or slang, yeah? So, you should use a medical... A scientific term. Eh? Next. Okay, when to write the title? So draft a provisional title at the beginning of the manuscript. Sometimes eh, you just write the title first. Yeah, title first. Just get some ideas. Write a very general title. And you can revise and refine that during the course of the writing. So jangan gitu ya. Eh, terus. Titlenya enggak cantik ya, diulang, ditulis kemula ya, sehingga yang di bawahnya belum ditulis lagi. Sehingga satu bulan, dua bulan hanya lekat di title saja. Yeah? This is very common among students. Yeah? Okay? So write the title, you can revise, you can refine during the course of the writing until the title reflects the content and become very attractive. Okay? Next. Okay, abstract. When do you write the abstract? When do you write the abstract?
Should be at the end of the...
Yes, it should be at the end of the paper. Yeah? When you have finished writing everything. Yeah? It's because it summarizes the major aspect of the paper. It's basically a mini version of the paper. At the most read part of the paper and at the beginning of the article and give readers the essence of the research done and format. Okay, most of the time, the MGMHS format yeah, up to only 300 words. You're right. Lebih dari itu, reject. Yeah, kalau sekarang ni kami lebih strict ya. Lebih daripada word counts 300, kita reject ya. Yeah? Atau... Kalau paper you itu boleh kita lihat boleh diterima, can be accepted for publication or can be sent for peer reviews for publication, we would advise you to cut down the numbers of your abstract, yeah, and it can be structured or unstructured, yeah. Next, okay, what should be in the abstract? It follows the major paper, yeah. So background, aims, methods, major findings and main interpretation. With students, yeah, kita lihat yeah, kalau di MGMHS, sometimes you want to put everything, all results you want to put there. So we actually advise you put in your result the major findings only. Yeah. Next, should be written last. Yeah, betul ya yeah, tadi. Should be written last. Important to write good abstract because it will be indexed in the major databases. Eh? Exclude reference. So there shouldn't be a reference in your abstract. And avoid using abbreviation, jargons or ambiguous term, unstructured or structured form. Eh? So kalau you lihat the MGMHS, yeah, MGMHS is I think sorry, MGMHS is, hold on, eh? Okay, MGMHS is unstructured, ya? Yeah? Unstructured, next. Okay, ini salah satu abstrak contoh ya di Malaysian Journal, Medical Journal of Malaysia. So ini yang kita panggil unstructured ya. Dia satu paragraf saja. Next. Okay, ini di dalam Journal Preventive Medicine. Nah, ini structured ya. Dia ada tulis objective, methods, result and conclusion. Kalau di MGMHS, it is unstructured ya. Satu paragraf gitu. Jadi you have to follow eh, to follow the guidelines eh. So next. Ah, ini juga structured dalam Journal of Sexual Medicine. Next. Okay. So what about your introduction? Okay, introduction ini the section which follows the abstract, it will stimulate readers' interest, yeah. Instill positive impression to readers and motivate readers to continue reading. So, dia ada dua component in introduction. It should be background formation and the purpose of the study. Next. So, the first component, basically, generally, it will provide readers with sufficient background information of the subject of interest. And then synthesize findings from the major research literatures, what others have done, and highlight nature of the problem and the potential significance. So ini lebih kepada problem statement ya. Yeah? So it must be there in your introduction. Yeah? And then second component, the first the purpose of your study. Next. The purpose of your study ya. Yeah? Okay, second component, so inform purpose of study, state clearly rationale of the study and provide information how hypothesis of the study came about and highlight why special or that what was the gap of your research, yeah? And why special or different about your research. Next. Okay, ini contohnya ya. Ini contohnya dalam satu jurnal gitu. So the first component, general introduction of the subject matter, and the second one is the next paragraph, what others have done with evidence. Next. And the last paragraph, rationale of undertaking the research. Okay, next. And hypothesis, yeah? And hypothesis and focus of the research. Okay, this is from the New England Journal of Medicine. It's a very high impact journal, yeah? High impact journal. Where the impact factor is almost 30 ni. Yeah. Next. Okay, what are the common errors, yeah, yang kita lihat dalam publication-nya, ya, yeah, selalu terlalu panjang, ya, yeah, too lengthy and rambling without any content, ya, yeah. Dia panjang dan cerita-ceritanya macam storytelling tapi enggak ada kontennya, scientific content. And missing of important previous work. And objectives are not clearly stated. And then you have extensive listing of reference and extensive critics of others' work and inclusion of data or conclusions from the previous work. Yeah? So there are too many of that. Yeah? Because you tahu kalau dalam introduction itu paling-palingnya itu 5 short paragraph gitu. Yeah? Next. Okay, this is very important. Materials and methods. Yeah? Kalau kita lihat kepada analisis, yeah, kalau dilihat kepada kebanyakan, yeah, kebanyakan, most of the submission, yeah, from yang kita lihat, yeah, daripada UNER dan juga ada different part of Indonesia, yeah, we notice that your methodology, yeah, is sometimes has some scientific issues there. There's some scientific issues there in term of your sample. Mungkin Ibu Ziza dengan Ibu Lilis, mungkin mungkin you have to take note of this lah. Because we notice one of the reasons because some of the reviewers dia lihat kepada your sample size. Lihat kepada sample size dan juga lihat kepada your sampling method and then your instruments that you use, and then so yang ini selalunya tiga perkara gitu and your analysis. Bila sample size sometimes terlalu kecil terlalu kecil, jadi bila reviewers most of the reviewers dia tengok kalau you justify your sample size, that should be okay. Contohnya kalau kata okay, you collect 100 respondents, you recruit 100 respondents and you justify in your writing why do you choose this 100, because based maybe they say based on your calculation. Okay, fine, we accept that based on your calculation. Based on your calculation, and then based on your calculation and then your sampling method. Sampling methods, most of the time reviewers dia akan lihat kalau the moment you say is a non-random sampling, they reject outrightly. Because you know non-random sampling method or non-probability sampling method would actually introduce a lot of biases there. And you cannot generalize it. You cannot generalize your results. So that is one of the areas. Maybe I understand that we also have the same problem with our master students. They said one is they do not have money. Second is they do not have time. Adequate time to actually collect the data. So as much as possible, you have to try. You estimate the sample size based on the calculation, okay, and you try as much as possible to do your random sampling, if you can. All right, so because these are the two areas that needs to be improved, not just UNAIR, it goes the same to our own students as well, our own candidates as well. So kita pun ada reject juga bila kita tengok when we look at the sample size, small sample size, sometimes your sample size is enough to just make it a preliminary study. It is not enough to make up to a very the actual study project. And then your analysis, ada juga kami dapat when I go through the manuscript, the analysis is just description. Kalau description is just you just describe lah. You don't do hypothesis. You do not have hypothesis. And you do not have this bivariate analysis. And sometimes you just describe. You describe berapa persen itu, berapa persen ini. So it doesn't give a very strong scientific merit to the paper. So sometimes that's the reason sometimes we actually reject. Okay. So materials, again. So what was done, how it was done, how data were collected, how data were analyzed. Descriptions of methods should allow others to report. So your description of methodology should be clear. So that when people read your paper, they should be able to understand what exactly that you have done. They should be able to repeat it. Okay. And there must be, they should include selection criteria of the subject, inclusion and exclusion criteria, because you know, when you have inclusion and exclusion criteria, you are actually taking care of the main confounders. You're trying to reduce the confounding factors. And then of course, informed consent, And your ethics approval from your IRB, Institute Regulatory Body. Okay, next. Okay, results gitu. Response rate, you should describe your respondents, you answer your objective. So you must answer your objective. Sometimes a student, they know that they have a lot of data, but they do not refer back to the objective. So in your paper, if you clearly describe your objective, you should go back to your objective. And this is sometimes what the reviewers comment. Eh? They comment that the authors do not answer the objective. What you presented in your result doesn't answer your objective. One, yeah? So that's the most common, one of the most common comments from the reviewers. Eh? And you present your descriptive data first, okay? And you use appropriate indicators and use tables, okay? The table should be self-explanatory, yeah? What you describe in the table, you cannot describe it in the text, yeah? And not during results, yeah? When you write your result, you do not actually draw a conclusion. You draw your conclusion after your discussion, okay? Next. Okay, writing discussion. Okay, this is the last component of the scientific article. So you should interpret the results. You should emphasize the new and important aspects and explain the implication of the findings and state the study weakness and limitation and suggestion for future research. Okay, yang ini ya, kita selalu lihat ya, you sometimes state the study limitation tu sangat panjang eh. And when you start doing this, eh, when you start elaborating on your study weakness and limitation, eh, so it means that from the point of the reviewers, yeah, it means that you are not taking care of this at the very beginning of your research. When your study have a lot of limitations, meaning that you do not carefully plan your study in order to minimize all these limitations. So you have to be very careful here. When you know, sometimes you want to be very honest, yeah, telling people in the paper that despite the finding, despite the result, you should look at the limitation. But if you have a long list of limitation, kalau limitation itu terlalu panjang, maksudnya apa? Maksudnya study itu terlalu banyak weakness, yeah, yang tidak dilihat daripada awal study lagi, yeah, okay. Next. Okay, ini components of discussion. Tadi kita sudah you should summarize the main findings, okay, and address them in relation to the research objective. Yeah, you must go back to your objective. Yeah, ini memang reviewers selalu nampak ya. They always comment this because they said you do not address your objective, and you in fact were discussing about something else which do not relate to your objective. Yeah? Explain the possible mechanisms of the new findings, if there is, yeah? And relate your results to previous results. So what do people from the previous work have done? Yeah? So why is your result different from the previous one? This should be critically discussed. Yeah, next. Okay. The principles and relationships drawn from the major findings. So you should describe them and put them in perspective. You cite others who made similar findings. And this should be in a logical sequence. Yeah? Logical sequence maksudnya mesti teratur gitu ya. Jadi bila reviewers baca ya, when they read, they read the manuscript, they have a good flow of understanding. Yeah? Okay, that would actually helps you in their comments and a chance to get accepted. Next. Okay, relate to previous works, compare and contrast. Okay. Alright, yang ini tadi discuss and evaluate conflicting findings. Ah, so okay, this indicates sign of good discussion. That's why sometimes kita when we write we feel that why is our results do not are not the same with the previous result? Actually, that would be good, yeah, it is a good thing to have that because that would give you more things to discuss. When your result do not, you know, do not concur with the previous work, yeah. So that will give you some ideas, and it's a sign of good discussion. Yeah. Okay, next. Okay, so what would be the implication of the current findings? So this is another thing that you should look at. Yeah. So what would be the implication on in terms of your practice? One, in terms of the policy. Okay, your findings, eh? The current finding, and in terms of your future research. So the implication on practice, the implication on policy, and the implication on your future research. Yeah. Next. Okay, weakness and limitation. Yeah. So yes, no study is perfect. Yeah. No study is perfect. So you should be able to to state your limitation, but not a very long list. Yeah. Jangan gitu ya. Satu senarai panjang ya. Yeah. Bila you have your own a list of limitation, it means that your study is, there's a lot of weakness in your study. Yeah. And comment on how this have affected the accuracy of the result or validity of the findings and their interpretation. Okay, next. Okay, tips on writing discussion. Okay, do not repeat the introduction and results. Sometimes reviewers, they notice that they would actually comment this in your paper. They notice that your discussion actually just repeating the introduction and just repeating the result. And it's not critically discussed. Yeah? And avoid introducing new results, meaning that you have to go back to your objective. That's why sometimes reviewers say, discussion doesn't relate to objective. You are out of the objective. Yeah? And avoid apologetic tone when discussing the limitation. Yeah? So, you know, do not be so apologetic, ya. Yeah? Jangan terlalu merendah diri mengatakan, oh, study ni, jadi terlalu macam apologetic lah. Eh? Jadi, kadang-kadang reviewer enggak suka, gitu. Yeah? Avoid lengthy explanation, must be brief and clear, and includes key and relevant references. And do not speculate, ya. Eh? Do not speculate.
Professor, your mic is muted.
How come?
Yeah.
Okay, can you hear?
Yeah, I can hear.
Okay. So, include key and do not speculate. Eh? So, you can give your opinion, but it should be based on the previous literatures. Eh? A few drafts may produce a satisfactory discussion. So, you need some draft, a few draft, before you can say that this is a good discussion. Next. Okay, writing a conclusion, summarize the main important findings, a link with the aim of the study, should be concise and should have a clear take-home message. So, apa itu clear take-home message daripada study kita gitu? Yeah? Okay, ini contohnya ya. Discussion. Okay, kalau dilihat ya. Di atas ini ya, actually is repeating the introduction. Ya. Yeah? Jadi enggak perlu tu. Yang hitam ini ya. Yang perlunya terus dimulai dari sini ya. You should start from the presence of depressive symptoms in the study was what. Yeah? And this one is actually just repeating the introduction. So this is the example. Okay, next. Okay, yang hijau ini ya, ini adalah bridging sentence. Yeah? So you want to link from one paragraph to another, okay? So you should use a bridging sentence. So yang hitam ini enggak perlu, ianya adalah repetition daripada introduction. yang merah ini terus, ya. Jadi you actually save more words, ya. You save.
Tentang Prof. Normala, ya. Yang kau tidak berubah, not change as me. Ya?
Sudah. Point?
Nah,
sudah berubah ini, Bu.
Sudah diperbaiki. Okay. Thank you.
Ah, boleh nampak ya?
Boleh nampak.
Boleh ya? Hijau kan? Ini nampak hijau kan? Hijau.
Ada tulisan di atas hijau, Bu.
Ah ya, betul. Ah, yang
lain,
hijau
yang lain bisa tampak kah?
Yes, yang lain. Bisa, Ibu. Atasnya warna hijau.
Sopo. Oke, bisa dilanjut, Prof.
Oke. Okay. Ya, jadi yang hitam ni enggak perlu kerana ianya adalah repetition dari introduction.
Di Kalimantan.
Ya.
Untuk para peserta, tolong mic-nya untuk di-mute terlebih dulu.
Oke. Okay. So, yang ini sepatutnya terus ditulis dengan tulisan merah ini, ya. Merah, dan ini juga repetition of the results, ya. It was observed in the study that majority. If you look at the result, resultnya gitu sama. Jadi, terusnya ke merah ini, ya. Next. Okay, sama juga gitu. Yang hitam ini sebenarnya adalah repetition from the introduction, ya. Yeah. So kita terus saja ke merah, ya. Yeah. In the presentation we found that there was no significant association, ya. Pasal issue that data regarding data are inconsistent. So our study result revealed that the presence was not okay. So terus saja gitu, ya. Yeah. Jadi you actually save more words di situ, ya. Yeah. Next. Okay, a few limitation, yeah. So what was the limitation? Sample size, yeah. Use of self-report. So just, you know, summarize everything. So you do not need to explain more about it, yeah. Next. So in conclusion, all opiate dependence patient treatment should be screened for depression, diagnosing and monitoring. Okay, so itu saja pendeknya, yeah. Enggak perlu di panjang-panjang gitu. Next. Okay. Alright. Ini contoh, ya. This is what I have done. Okay. Progressive muscle relaxation. Okay, this is the example before we publish, ya. This is a work I collaborated with my counterpart in Indonesia juga, ya, yeah. Di mana kami menjadi consultant, ya, yeah, kepada pencara ini, ya, yeah, dosen ini untuk make sure that they publish, ya, yeah. So this is the example, the first draft that came to us, ya, yeah, when we discuss, ya, yeah. Ini adalah example-nya, ya, yeah. Abstract-nya saja yang saya tunjuk, ya, yeah. Jadi kalau dilihat kepada abstraknya di sini, ya, this is actually prevalence, ya, prevalence of chronic kidney disease increase as the result. So kalau tengok pada background dan the purpose, ya, yang perlu banyak diperbaiki gitu, ya. So this is before publication, ya, before publication. Okay, so kita selepas itu kita telah berbaiki dan this is what we have. Yeah, kita, you look at the tadi itu structured abstract, ya. Yeah? Ini unstructured, yeah, because kita mengikuti formatnya gitu, ya. Yeah? And we managed to publish this, ya. Yeah? After a very many times, ya. Yeah? We discuss and we come up with the draft, ya. Yeah? So finally, we managed to publish, and if you compare the two, eh, so it's really, you know, much more acceptable for publication, yeah, yang ininya, yeah, okay. Okay, so reference to my lectures just now is actually all this, yeah, you can actually Google, and eh, all this can be Google and found, eh, dalam Singapore Medical Journal, yeah. There is a very nice issues, yeah, talking about how to do effective writing lah, medical. Tapi sebenarnya sama saja. Kalau scientific writing itu, yeah, tiada perbezaan pun ya. So all this lah my reference ya. And then okay, I think sebagai macam mana yang tadi saya sebut ya. Kalau daripada Unair sendiri ya, kalau dilihat kepada manuskrip ya, kebanyakannya yang saya boleh katakan ya, I think you need to improve in term of methodology, that is one. Ya, dan juga dari segi English itu ya, kalau sekiranya ya university ya, universitas atau UNER itu ada proofreading services ya. Proofreading services that would be very helpful ya. Because kalau kalau
saya ice cream and put syrup on top and they called it a sundae.
Para peserta tolong di mute mikrofonnya.
Ya. Yeah. Kalau di Malaysia kan, kalau kita selalunya sebelum hantar kepada sebelum kita submit ya, di journal itu kita memang hantar kita memang send for proofreading first ya, yeah? Proofreading. In fact, when we send for proofreading also, when we submit to a journal, they still ask us eh, to go for another proofreading, yeah, saying that there's a lot of grammatical errors, yeah. So itu memang so if you really want to have to be accepted at first stage, yeah, maybe if you can have that kind of services, yeah, to proofread your paper first, that will be better, yeah. So saya rasa itu sahaja untuk kuliah saya ini. Jadi mungkin ada pertanyaan itu Ibu Lilis ada hantarin kan list tu, cuma saya belum mendapat. Sebab list itu dia perlulah mendapat kebenaran daripada dokternya, yeah, ya, untuk didiskus. Saya takut ada isu, yeah, ya, mungkin some maybe feel offended ke apa ke ya. Ya. Yeah?
Okay. Maybe we can start the discussion session.
Ya, okay. Boleh.
Okay. Pada sekarang kita masuk ke sesi diskusi. Apabila ada yang hendak bertanya, bisa tuliskan pertanyaannya di kolom chat untuk bisa saya bacakan. Oke. Okay. Ada satu pertanyaan dari Ibu Retno, salah satu dosen Universitas Erlangga juga.
Iya. Yeah.
Terkait dengan suggestion reviewer from author, are there some qualification for the reviewer?
Okay. Kita di MGMHS, kita enggak ada satu list lah atau characteristic criteria untuk reviewers. Tetapi we would advise, we would encourage you to find reviewers that are familiar with scientific writing. And of course, you need content lah, content expert. So, satunya, reviewer yang memang expert di bahagian di certain topics ya. Yeah. Kalau di kesihatan lingkungan, mungkin you have to find reviewers from kesihatan lingkungan. Dan juga yang familiar ya, yeah, familiar with scientific writing ya. Yeah. In term of comment on the methodology, on the the objective and so on.
Bagaimana, Bretno?
Yes, okay, thank you.
Okay.
Terima kasih. Bagi peserta yang hendak bertanya bisa tuliskan di kolom chatnya ya pertanyaannya. Ini saya ada mendapatkan pertanyaan juga dari luar chat.
Yeah.
Pertanyaan dari Zia Zuhairo, mahasiswi Universitas Erlangga. Dia menanyakan terkait review article.
Ah, okay.
Apakah terdapat minimal referensi untuk review article? jika memang tidak terpenuhi, apakah langkah selanjutnya apakah di reject seperti itu?
Okay, at the moment kita untuk review artikel ada beberapa there are a few types. One is your narrative review. Narrative review ini dia enggak systematic lah. So second is actually systematic review. Systematic review and also meta analysis. So kalau systematic review dan meta analysis, you should follow a guideline. A guideline, international or standard guideline, which is coming from for systematic review, you have this PRISMA guideline. PRISMA guideline itu macam kalau randomized control trial, you follow the consort guidelines. Kalau untuk systematic review and meta analysis is PRISMA guideline or quorum guideline, they call it QURUM, quorum guideline. So kalau narrative review, dia because it's too general, so it doesn't follow any guidelines lah. Tetapi review ini sebenarnya kalau kita lihat dia boleh dalam dia kalau the words count tu lebih kurang I would expect lebih kurang macam original article or full article kan. Jadi reference-nya itu enggak terbatas. You can put as much as many as you can, as long as you cite, you know, the reference actually should be cited in your paper lah. So it doesn't have a limitation dekat situ.
Okay. On to the next question from Ulfa dari Universitas Erlangga. What issues are most interesting or liked by MGMHS?
Okay, kalau kita MGMHS, Malaysian Journal of Medicine and Health Sciences, anything under that is our interest actually. Medicine and Health Sciences. So Health Sciences itu luas ya, luas. Kan? Kalau environmental health itu juga luas ya. Jadi yang saya lihat ya, kurangnya daripada kesihatan lingkungan ya, is actually the fundamental research. Kalau kita lihat ya, kalau kita banyak applied research kan. Contohnya saya rasa dulu kita ada discuss ya dengan Prof. Ju and Pak siapa ya Prof. Ju dulu? Pak mana ya? Lupa saya.
Pak Rahim eh?
Pak Rahim. Kita pernah discuss dengan Pak Rahim ya. Bila collect data ya, or collect all the respondents and you know information from respondents, then you should actually tailor. You should actually go deeper, meaning that go back to basic sciences, yeah, atau buat fundamental research looking at the molecular level or something like that, at the molecular level. Yang itu kita rasa would be much more interesting, yeah. Dan akan memberi lagi high impact untuk because apa yang kita buat ya, kalau di environmental health ini lebih kurang sama dengan public health kan, dia lebih kepada lihat kepada objective measurement dan sebagainya ya. Tapi how do you relate that into the molecular level, yeah, so that would be more fundamental and much more interesting, yeah. You nak cakap pasal genetic, so what is genetic things that you can actually include in your study. So that is one of the areas that maybe you can think of. Yeah. Kita lihat kalau kita lihat scope journal scope MGMHS tu, if you have new interesting findings kan. Yeah, new interesting findings that will be much better.
Okay. So next question from Amalia from Universitas Erlangga. Apakah terdapat application to plagiarism check for free that trusted before we try to submit to the journal?
Kalau Turnitin ini selalunya is a software that you have to buy kan? Turnitin. Yeah. Kalau di UNER ada ke? kalau kita di UPM ini daripada library sebenarnya, kita punya perpustakaan ya. Library actually provide this Turnitin software, which they have to buy lah. They have to buy, maybe renew the license every year or something like that. Memang boleh, memang terdapatnya apa? Terdapatnya yang free gitu ya. Tetapi how how confident are we? Because kita takut nanti dia capture our data and you know it can be manipulated. Ha, itu salah satu ni lah. Tapi mungkin Prof Ju mungkin ada experience ke with the free software for plagiarism?
Saya juga guna Turnitin juga lah, sama.
Nah ha, kan. Ha. Tapi memang di, kalau mahasiswa di UPM mereka tahu ada yang free lah. Tapi kita tak we do not encourage that because kita takut you punya data itu kan diambil dan dimanipulasikan. Tiba-tiba nanti ada satu publication sudah keluar. Gitu.
Itu berapa? Ada masker juga tanda kesan?
Iya.
Saya enggak terlalu.
Okay. Sorry. Mungkin itu jawabannya. The next question dari Anita dari UNEDS. Apakah yang diterima hanya quantitative research? How about the qualitative research?
Okay, kami menerima juga qualitative research. Ya. Tetapi kita lihat kebanyakan qualitative research yang kami terima itu tidak mencapai quality qualitative research. Ya, kalau mahasiswa semua biasa ya, familiar with qualitative research, it is very rich in description. Ya. Yeah? Dan juga dia walaupun dia qualitative ya, enggak ada methodology tertentu, tetapi dia masih ada lagi methodology mengikut qualitative ya. Yeah? Jadi kalau kita ikut kepada guidelines ya, yeah, untuk publication, you should refer to certain guidelines ya, yeah, for qualitative research. There is guidelines for qualitative research, ya. Yeah? And if you look at, I think ada satu guidelines ya. Kalau you Google lah, memang ada guidelines yang macam tadi saya cakap ya. Kalau systematic review, you follow Prisma guidelines ya. You follow Quorum guidelines. Kalau RCT, randomized control trial, you follow consort guidelines ya. Untuk qualitative research, memang you boleh follow apa tu? Certain guidelines. Saya pun enggak lupa juga namanya. Nanti kalau you Google, you memang ada standard guidelines untuk qualitative research. Dan you perlu bila untuk publish ya, you perlu ikut guidelines tu. Because the guidelines will guide you what are the contents of your manuscript, ya, yeah, in relation to qualitative research. Jadi memang kita ada. Kita memang menerima qualitative research.
Ah, ya. Ini baru saja Prof. Juliana memberikan internet
di chat,
ya.
Under environmental.
Ya, yeah. Ini yang ini your department kan, Ju? Yeah.
Environmental and occupational.
This is a special issue from Department of Environmental and Occupational Health by led by Prof. Juliana lah, ya, yang kita publish di MJ-MHS.
Mungkin teman-teman
boleh klik dan
ini bisa pelajari.
Iya.
Okay. Ada pertanyaan lagi dari Alhamdani. Berapa jumlah or percentage of article review yang diterima dalam satu kali terbit? And jika terbitan pada tahun ini sudah penuh, apakah artikel yang belum diperiksa akan diterbitkan pada tahun berikutnya?
Ya, yeah. Kita itu ikut turutan ya. Up until December, we actually have full. Yeah. So if you ask me, I want to publish this year, cannot ah, cannot begitu. sudah cukup limitnya. Yeah. Okay. We have 60 articles in our December issues, and previous issue we have about 50, so almost like 200 plus lah. This year saja. Jadi ikut turutannya, sekarang ni kita banyak dalam proses peer review lagi, ya. So artikel tu bila sudah accepted akan masuk January, ya, January. January 2021. Ya. Dan akan masuk lagi lepas tu January, May, September and December. So ikut turutan. Memang kita ikut turutan.
Okay. Sepertinya sudah ada sudah tidak ada pertanyaan baru.
Yeah.
Mungkin untuk sesi ini saya bisa simpulkan terlebih dulu. Bu Aziza ada tambahan Bu Aziza?
Ya, mungkin timeline-nya Prof. Normala bagi...
Oke, okay, timeline-nya kita... tadi kan saya kata, kalau admin processing checklist itu sepatutnya dalam dalam satu minggu lah ya, satu minggu. Eh. Tetapi sekarang ini sebab submission-nya terlalu banyak ya, jadi kita, I think from our secretariat also I have to look at that lah. Eh. Kita akan mempercepatkan untuk checklist itu. Sebab kita hanyanya ada satu orang yang check semua. Satu staff yang check semua itu. Ya. Jadi kita setakat ini ada 800 submission gitu ya. Jadinya dia memang, yalah, tak apa, itu nanti kita akan lihat. Dan peer review process should within 21 days lah. Ya.
21 days.
Once it's already go through the checklist, kita akan hantar ke chief editor and chief editor akan allocate to associate editor dan akan find the apa ni, kita akan select the reviewers lah ya. Dan memang ini memang kita selalunya akan every 2 days kita akan buka email untuk lihat yeah. Untuk masuk ke portal ya, untuk lihat
lumayan melelahkan admin kepada
ya. Ya benar.
Ya, pada intinya kan finally kita menunggunya itu kira-kira sampai lebih kurang 1 bulan begitu ya. Kalau
ya sepatutnya lah
diterima atau tidaknya itu 1 bulan gitu.
Nah, 1 bulan tapi kalau sudah ke reviewer itu memang sebenarnya reviewer juga ada isu di situlah. Reviewer ini kadang-kadangnya lambat ya. Dia yeah. That's why kita kata if possible you suggest your reviewers.
Yeah.
So senang kita untuk terus invite the reviewers to review your paper.
Ya, yeah, karena kan ini menjadi persyaratan kelulusan minimal dapat letter of acceptance dulu sebelum dipublish. Mungkin kalau diterima itu menjadi tiket mahasiswa untuk dia istilahnya berhasil dalam publikasi, meskipun mungkin tahun depan di publish-nya. Jadi minimal LOA-nya, LOA.
Ah, iyalah, ya. Yeah. Tapi that should go through a review process first lah.
Ya.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you, Prof. Normala.
Okay.
Terima kasih, Bu Aziza.
Prof. Juliana juga thank you so much. Okay. Sudah. Besok Rabu kita ketemu lagi ya.
Oh, ada lagi acara ya?
Iya, ada acara. By research, Prof Normala, kita ada by research environmental health UPM dan UNER. Kita buka kelas untuk 2021.
Ah, ini dual degree ya?
Dual degree, betul.
Oh, start. Sudah, oke. Okay. Alhamdulillah.
Ya, insya Allah. Nanti kita
berhasil
bisa.
Berhasil ya.
Amin. Ya Rabbal Alamin. Ya. Nanti kita terus berkarya lagi.
Iya, iya.
Terus.
Ya, tunggu. Ya. The door is open ya. Saya mau ke Surabaya lagi.
Ayo, mantap.
Mau ke Bromo lagi.
Ayo, Alhamdulillah. Ya, saya kembalikan ke moderator.
Rindu mau ke Indonesia.
Ya, betul. Iya, saya juga rindu ke Malaysia.
Sekarang bordernya tutup semua ya.
Ya, itu dia. Ke Bu Lilis mungkin, Mas Asmi.
Oh iya. Bu Lilis, ada tambahan mungkin?
Sudah, Asmi. Terima kasih, Bu Nurmala. Sudah jelas. Dan terima kasih tadi sharingnya dari Prof. Juliana. Sudah di...
Saya harap ianya hari ini memang apa yang saya beri ini ya, harapnya berguna ya.
Amin. Ya Rabbal Alamin. Ya.
Oke. Untuk kesimpulan pada materi hari ini, MGMHS adalah salah satu jurnal yang dikelola oleh UPM Press yang saat ini terindeks oleh Scopus dan kedepannya proses untuk terindeks ke GCR. Salah satu untuk alasan kenapa sebuah artikel itu dapat ditolak pada dasarnya adalah sang penulis tidak mengikuti format ataupun juga terdapat plagiarisme yang cukup besar seperti itu. Yang nantinya dari pihak MGMHS akan memberikan saran atau meminta kepada penulis untuk menyesuaikan kembali tulisannya seperti itu. Untuk tips untuk successful publication, pada intinya adalah sebuah artikel kita harus apapun bentuknya harus membawa keterbaruan untuk kemajuan ilmu pengetahuan khususnya di bidang kesehatan dan perobatan seperti itu. Oke. Terima kasih kepada Profesor Dr. Nirmala Ibrahim atas materi yang disampaikan. Dengan demikian berakhirlah sesi dari this lecture hari ini. Saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada Profesor Dr. Nirmala Ibrahim. Kita berikan aplaus kepada beliau.
Oke, terima kasih. Semoga kita ketemu lagi ya.
Iya.
Amin.
Insyaallah.
Amin. Insyaallah.
Amin ya rabbal alamin.
Amin.
Terima kasih semuanya. Sehat selalu. COVID segera pergi dari bumi.
Ini emailnya saya ya. Kalau sekiranya mahu diajukan apa-apa soalannya, saya di situ ya emailnya saya.
Oke. Okay. Yeah, thank you, bro.
Oke. Okay.
Selanjutnya saya kembalikan ke MC.
Iya. Yeah. Baik, terima kasih kepada Muhammad Azmi Ma'ruf, SKM. Pengumuman untuk kepada para peserta kuliah tamu yang ingin mendapatkan sertifikat dan materi dimohon untuk mengisi evaluation form setelah acara ini berakhir. Materi presentasi narasumber akan kami kirimkan bersama dengan sertifikat ke email masing-masing peserta yang telah mengisi presensi dan evaluation form. Baik, acara selanjutnya yaitu penyerahan sertifikat oleh Ibu Dr. Insinyur Lili Sulistiorini MKes selaku Ketua Departemen Kesehatan Lingkungan Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Erlangga kepada Ibu Prof. Nirmala Ibrahim. Kepada Bu Lili dipersilahkan, Bu.
Ya, gimana ya? Diserahkan sertifikatnya.
Online.
Ini kita serahkan
online.
Oke, terima kasih. Terima kasih, terima kasih banyak-banyak.
Iya.
Terima kasih. Sama-sama. Saya tadi terpikir ya, bagaimana terus mau diserahkan sertifikatnya. Oke, online.
Virtual, bro. Terima kasih. Menyerahkannya.
Ya, oke. Terima kasih ya. Terima kasih kepada
sama-sama. Terima kasih
semua. Oke.
Baik, terima kasih kepada Bu Lilis dan Prof. Nirmala. Acara selanjutnya yaitu penutupan dan pembacaan doa. Pembacaan doa akan dipimpin oleh rekan saya Ahmed Ayatullah SKM. Kepada rekan saya Ahmed Ayatullah SKM, kami persilahkan.
Terima kasih. Mari kita tundukkan kepala sejenak seraya memohon ampun kepada Allah Subhanahu wa taala dan semoga apa yang kita lakukan pada hari ini diberkahi. Kita akhir kegiatan hari ini dengan istighfar dan doa kafaratul majelis. Astagfirullah. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Asyhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astagfiruka wa atubu ilaik.
Terima kasih kepada Ahmed Ayatullah SKM. Alhamdulillah kita telah sampai di penghujung acara. Terima kasih kami ucapkan kepada narasumber, moderator, serta para peserta yang telah menyimak acara ini, mulai dari awal sampai dengan selesai. Semoga ilmu yang didapat pada hari ini dapat berguna dan dapat kita aplikasikan. Saya mewakili panitia yang bertugas menyampaikan, mohon maaf apabila ada kata-kata dan perbuatan yang salah atau mungkin kurang berkenan. Saya sebagai MC pamit undur diri, sampai jumpa di kuliah tamu selanjutnya.
Foto bersama dulu.
Oh, foto, ada foto ya.
Oh iya, foto. Sekarang 1, 2, 3 ya. Siapa yang mau Tony?
Saya pun. Oke, 1, 2, 3.
Terima kasih, Mbak Rahminda. Sampai jumpa di acara kuliah tamu selanjutnya. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Oke. Terima kasih ya. Assalamualaikum.
Terima
kasih Bu Rahmana. Iya. Jangan di close dulu ya.
Terima kasih.
Panitia jangan close dulu soalnya peserta masih ngisi form evaluasi.
Baik.
Terima kasih. Jadi
Saya aja boleh keluar ya.
Boleh keluar.
Boleh. Terima kasih Prof Juliana.
Iya. Terima kasih Bunda Nyoman, Bu Nyoman Anita, Damayanti.
Terima kasih Bunda Nyoman.
Terima kasih. 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 Terima kasih.